Just now.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody, for coming in this evening. Nice big crowd. Welcome, everybody, and not just to CJ's lecture this evening, but to the launch of the autumn lecture series here at the AA. It's a great pleasure that we're able to start this season series, which will feature flying in from around the world with someone who's only a few minutes away up the road. The commute was considerably easier this evening for CJ to come down from the Bartlett School where he teaches, although it's a trip that's taken many more years than you would think given the distance involved. It's a great pleasure to welcome someone back to the school who studied here 20-ish years ago in the diploma school where I first met CJ, where we studied together in Diploma Unit 6. He has, since the early 90s, been a distinguished and influential teacher at the Bartlett School of Architecture. The work of his students have received, I think, by any account, far more awards than any other living architect in the universe. His students have done some of the most outstanding and interesting projects in the UK and really throughout the world, and they're all tied very much to the agendas and ambitions of CJ's own work, which really began here as his work as a student. His relationship between it's the relationship between drawing and the assembling of objects into works of art or architecture that's been the focus for many, many years in both the studios he teaches and the work he does as an architect. And not just assembly, but really the modernist history of assemblage, which filters through the work of artists like Duchamp and Schwitters and Joseph Cornell, who invented in the early years of the 20th century a way of making art objects out of found objects, which I think is a discourse never really has played through architecture to the degree that many of us assumed, even 20 years ago when we were thinking about it as students in places like this. CJ's been sort of relentless in his pursuit of that ambition and the idea that you can build architectural projects into genuinely cultural projects and agendas, which has been the focus of his work that I think many of you already know. He's currently got a small exhibition on at the V&A Museum here in London, which will be up, I think, through next spring, if I'm right. Seasons Through a Looking Glass, which is one of many installations that he's done in recent years, which explores his work at a larger scale, kind of prototype installation sort of size. Virtually Venice in 2004 is an example of that kind of work, when CJ installed a series of pieces throughout Venice to explore an agenda that focused the theme that year. His interest in spatial storytelling and the idea of architectural narrative, I think, is one of the strongest genealogies that's run through his amazing studio's body of work for the last 20 years. And it's work that I think many of you will know through a beautiful set of three small publications, which came out in, I would say, about 5 years ago in a series of three volumes called Realms of Impossibility, which presents his work, I think, in a beautiful way, but I think more than anything confirms that he's one of the really great, let's say, drawers of architecture in an age in which that topic, I think, has been challenged by many people, but which he keeps alive in his work in countless ways. It's a great pleasure to welcome CJ back down to Bedford Square.
Thank you very much. Could somebody move in front, because there are many more seats here? It'll be much more comfortable then. Come on, if you guys could come and sit in front. Because there are lots of people standing by the door. Could people just move up? Yeah, come on, move up. I won't eat you. I promise, whatever my students tell you is not true. I'm very nice. Come on, just move up here. Sit in front. It's much better than, because there are loads of people at the doorway. Yeah, come in front. Come on, sit in front of the carpet here. It's much better. No? Why do you guys, just one more second. Just all, you bunch, sit here. Yeah. Okay, are we all comfortable now? Can you hear me? Is the mic working? At the back? I think it's working. Brett, thank you so much for inviting me here tonight. I'm very touched. This is, and all of you for coming, because this is an amazing homecoming for me. It takes four chairmen of your institution to invite me here. So three. Is it three? But it's a long time. I'm very, very honored by all of you coming here tonight and having such a packed audience. I think originally when I was planning this lecture, I didn't intend to show you what I'll be showing you in the next few minutes. But because I have never lectured here before, and it's a homecoming, I think I should go back all the way to when I was an infant in this building. No, I'm kidding. Otherwise, we'll be here for 2 weeks. So I will show you a little snippet. Thank you. the lights off, please? Could I have the lights off, please? All the lights off, please. I thought I had problems with technology. Could I have the lights off here, please? Great, thank you. Okay. I think I've shown you about 40, 42 projects there. I think I counted it last week. We have worked on 119 projects. So I will have over 70 more projects to torture you with this evening. No, I'm just joking. I will show you about 5 more projects only this evening. So, but that shows you the kind of the range of projects we have been working on over the number of years. I think we have been most productive over the last 2 years or so. I think you could also see that the range of work changed from very small scale, very narrative based, and then the projects got larger. And I'll be showing you some of the largest projects we have worked on in the next few minutes. This one here, I just want to say that for those who have not seen it, do go and have a little look at this installation at the V&A tunnel. But whatever you do, please don't steal the t-shirts. They have been plucking the flowers off this thing every day. So the things that, you know, I heard that even the security guards have been taking the t-shirts off. So it's changing colors. It will change again. It will morph into a different texture and color next in a couple of months' time. Tonight, I'll be speaking predominantly about projects in Asia, and in China in particular. We have been incredibly fortunate to have the chance to be invited by the Chinese government to participate in numerous very large-scale projects. And the first one I'll be showing you was the largest one. It was about 8 kilometers square. Just to give you a rough idea how big 8 kilometers square is, it's about 2.5 times Hyde Park. So that's how large it is. And for us, we are very used to working on projects which is about one building scale, to do a master plan proposal for, which is 2.5 times Hyde Park, was a phenomenally scary, exciting, exhilarating experience. And when we were invited, when we put our bid in, we actually said, they said, have you done a master plan before? We actually said, yes, with the fingers crossed. It was a little white lie. But then, since then, we have done more than our fair share of work. I think, and I do mean it very sincerely, that the Chinese government has been extremely supportive of us, you know, with our proposals and so forth. And I think it's really encouraging to see that China is very open, very easy to really, they want to adopt and adapt interesting new ideas. They are not like this government here in the UK, where everything is about being expensive, we cannot do this, we can't do that. And I think it's refreshing. I mean, I cannot see in my lifetime that I will be invited to do a project by the English government at this scale. This is a picture, so much for bitching about the UK government. I'll move on swiftly. This is an image of Shenzhen. Shenzhen is south of China. This is not a photo montage. I know it looks a little bit like a metropolis with the airship floating above with the smog and all that thing. It is real smog, and I'm sure you know what smog is, yeah? This is our site here, Shenzhen City. Hong Kong is here. Guangzhou is up here. So that gives you an idea of the proximity of the site. The airport is very close by. The proposal was for an eco-city. China has promised the United Nations that they would deliver 5 eco-cities by 2020. The first one, obviously, I'm sure you all know very well, is Dongtan by Arabs Associates. And this was supposedly the second one. The piece of land to be developed is this rich agricultural land. Farmers, they produce vegetables, dairy product, meats for Hong Kong and Guangzhou. And when we visited the site, it was really quite sad and tragic to see this green, beautiful landscape wiped out, skyscrapers replacing them, and the community displaced. And you can see why I'm absolutely fascinated by this sort of landscape that was provided. And also, the area was famous for lychees, filled with lychee orchards everywhere. These are the local sort of housing, existing housings for farmers, farming families. This is a problem that we saw that the Chinese government seemed to have ignored completely in their big vision for China. What they do is that they generally buy the land off the farmers. They take them off them, give them a new apartment in a tower block, give them a little bit of money, but then there's no program, social program, to place them with new work or in an area that requires their very limited skills. And the thing is that, to us, that was really quite tragic. And I think, for me, when we talked to the Chinese government, we said, you know, could we keep the community? Could we keep the farmland? And the answer was, as long as you could provide us with 250,000 households, you can keep anything you want. So that was actually our ambition. It was that, to us, the farming community, they are the people that will save China. They are really the eco-warriors. On many accounts, I'll explain it through the project, because the things that, you know, it's not because they put some green on the landscape, but they will really basically save food from being imported from far away, burning fuels, collecting sort of air miles, food miles on these things, basic things like that. And we felt that they become a very important part of the workings of a city, of this new city. As I've said, the city, this gives you a sense scale of how big it is. The middle slide is Manhattan, Central Park, Forbidden City on the first one, and Hyde Park. What we wanted also was that we wanted a slow city for China. The Chinese government was very shocked that we wanted a slow city. They said, why do we want a slow city? China can do anything faster than anybody else. Why do you want a slow city? I said, China will get tired one day. And when you get tired, you want to slow down. So the thing is that you can build as many Shanghai's as you want, as many sort of Guangzhou's as you want, and Shenzhen's. But the thing is that here within Shenzhen, you have a little pocket where you can stop and rest and think. And so our proposal was that not only is it sort of slow in a cultural sense, in a sort of social sense, but also that in terms of movement too. We want it to be a car-free city. And it's really funny because the thing is that tonight I'm going to be telling you little stories, actually. They say, okay, we'll have a car-free city. And they said, but then you still have to provide one car park space per household, which is a very, very high percentage compared to anything in Europe, for example. And then they said, you know, I said, but it's a car-free city. Why do you need all these car park spaces? Think about it. In 1 minute, you can tell me the answer. They said to me, you obviously don't understand Chinese culture. We might not want to drive the car, we still would like to polish our BMWs. So the thing is that was why we had to provide them with lots of car park spaces. Sorry. So Guangming is the hybrid of two, the urban and the agricultural landscape. We want to keep the food production, the dairy production, the vegetable production. Excuse me. These are some of the textures that we intend to superimpose onto the landscape. Here is the very basic master plan, a diagram. This was the initial diagram, where this is the entire site. There's a river, which is absolutely filthy. We suggest that they should clean up. Then the water we brought in. You think I'm complaining the whole evening, don't you? No. Honestly, you haven't seen rivers and canals in China. They're absolutely filthy. And the Chinese government acknowledged that it's a problem too, but they also acknowledged that it will cost a lot of money to really clean up. So we bring the canal in, and around it is a beach. I'm sorry, I have to. With all this coughing, by the end of the evening, I'll sound like Barry White here. So why do you want to bring a beach, you would say? Remember, this is Shenzhen. The majority of the population there are blue-collar workers. They work in factories. They couldn't afford to go to the very beautiful, expensive beaches around the edges of China. So instead of them going to the beach, we bring the beach to them. And on this site alone, there are many, many hills. And what we did was we actually accentuated the hills and made them into housing suburbs. And on top of each suburb, the orange patches, they are the center of excellence. The center of excellence meaning sort of libraries, trade centers, town halls. So you have a town hall at one end, the train station that passes through from Hong Kong all the way to Guangzhou to Beijing now on this through this station. And linking this sort of center of excellence up in the sky is a very slow sky bus route. That's the model. For those who have seen the China Designer exhibition at the V&A a few months ago, you would have probably seen this model there. That was a preliminary idea. It shows the sort of these towers, housing suburbs. And the housing suburbs towers are very inspired by these Hakka housing. They are these original courtyard housing. The other inspiration was Tower Babel. The Tower Babel, you know, the aspiration to have this sort of idyllic living. So this was a plan, that the master plan that we provided eventually. And so these are the kind of Tower Babels, or what we call, some of them are sunken. They are called craters. And the other thing is that what we have on the edge is this lychee border. The lychee border form a natural filtration edge to filter some of the pollution from the industry, from the factories passing through it. This was a very funny diagram, because the thing is that it was the first time we did a master plan. And obviously, we couldn't fulfill the numbers. And little do we know that, you know, the way that planners and architects design master plans are quite different, because the thing is that architects are trained to think 3D. Planners only think 2D. Shit, I'm going to offend somebody here now. Any planners here? No. Okay. No, but the thing is that it's true. They have one color, and that color represents the floor meterage, whatever that they have. And what we have is that we start to stack things. And when we started stacking things, the figures do not stack up at all. And it was very difficult. And this is a plan that I absolutely hate, because they force us to put little numbers. We have to calculate every single bit. And for us to do a master plan for the first time, it was tough going. And you can see the gray, the light gray is the natural hill. And the darker gray is the build-up terraces. So these Tower of Babels, these towers, suburbs, are terraced. What you have is that you have housing and agriculture interweave into each other. The new landscape is completely made up by rubbish. Rubbish that we from the UK sent over to China, strangely enough. And I'm not making this up, because the thing is that there's a whole documentary by BBC that exposes it all, that you get sort of bacon packs from Tesco's Abbey National Bank statements, Barclays Bank statements, you know, everything that is from here. What happens is that when these tankers come into UK, they bring us clothes, toys, everything. And then what we do is that we ship our rubbish to China to be sorted out. And there are whole villages in China that are sorting out these rubbish. So we thought it would be really kind of interesting to make something positive out of them. And this is what one of the suburbs would look like. You have housing interleaved with the roof terrace. These roof terraces will be for agriculture. And what we managed to do was to actually retain all the floor surfaces, all the ground surfaces, and provide just a tiny bit more for farming. So we managed to put in 250,000 people, retain the farmers, retain the farmland, and I think we were, just on that note, we were quite pleased with ourselves. So when you see green, that's the farming, but it also represents the housing beneath it. The suburb square, right on top of the tower, there's a reservoir. The reservoir to keep water. The reservoir that would become the suburb plaza. And each of those suburbs are self-sustainable in a way that they do not need to travel across to other suburbs, unless on the weekends or unless they are going to visit one of the centers of excellence. And here, instead of actually having concrete paved and all that thing for a plaza, this public space is just water. Water surface for farmers market on the weekends. A cultural venue. You see, I play this trick on every single time I do this lecture. If I can tell if you're a good audience or not. If you giggle on this image, you're okay. This is the image that we really, this sums up our project. We want to bring technology and status to these eco-warriors. We want to say that, you know, farming is not so bad after all. You could really do a lot to help the economy and healthy living for the community. The lychee orchards that filters the dust and pollution. The sort of final model, looking at the towers and craters and this new network of the slow skybus. The vertical gardens and the vertical farms. The buggy stops and the bicycle stops. The tower next to the crater. The tower next to the crater. The funicular connections. I think when the client saw these sort of pie shaped master plan, they panicked. They said that we don't want circular buildings. They don't realize that a circle is made of many, 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 many straight lines. And they don't realize how big each of these things are. It's a whole suburb. The largest one is about the size of Hampstead and West Hampstead and a bit of Kilburn. So you can imagine how big it is. And the things that we then have to prove to them that you can actually make rectangular or square buildings if you want to. I think at that point I was patronizing a bit because I thought, you know, a big circular shape doesn't mean that you have to have circular buildings. So what we did within each of those suburbs, that we worked out the sort of circulate the day in the life of one inhabitant. This one is the child from going from the apartment all the way to school, which is up in the top of the suburb square, the suburb square containing sort of shops, banks, tailors, laundrettes, and so forth. This is where granny goes from number 8 all the way to visit her friends in 1, 9, and 7, and then having a good gossip and lunch at number 4. And the relationship between ownership of apartments and green farming land. what was really exciting about this project was the first time we actually had to do transport. I've never designed anything beyond anything transport means car park to me, but then this is much more than that. We actually have to work out how to incorporate the new expressway that goes from Hong Kong all the way to Beijing, and then also local routes, and the one on the far right is the bus routes. Because there are no cars allowed, the cars were parked underneath the circular suburbs. The shaded bits are just the broadwalk for cyclists and pedestrians. There are three centers to it. One is around the train station, one is around the town hall, and one is around the old town center where we have to refurbish and reincorporate. The sky route, the suburb streets, and the funicular that takes you from ground all the way to the top of the suburb square. We were very fortunate also. We worked with Fulcrum. Andy and Brian, they are absolutely wonderful geniuses that we work with on these sustainable environmental programs. And they actually work out, I mean, this is what I'm showing you of this project is only a fraction of what work we had to produce over a period between 4 months for the first stage and then another 4 months, like a kind of 8 months project, all in all. And these are some of the kind of calculation if we were to implement some of our ideas. This is how much saving you would get within Guangming Smart City, and this is what a typical city of the same size we would spend on energy. I think what was really important for us to, you know, we didn't call it Guangming Smart City because we want to be pretentious. There are so many eco-cities these days. Everybody wants eco-cities. I will show you other eco-cities which are not Chinese too in a moment. We just wanted, I think what was really important for us is that most of the eco-cities, really, they don't really consider the social program. They don't really consider what will happen to people who are living on this piece of land. And to us, that was very, very important. So a smart city, I think, has to go beyond sort of renewable energies and energy saving and green living and healthy air and so forth. I think that's very, you know, I think eco-cities has greater responsibilities than that. Here, you know, with Fulcrum, we worked out how we can actually save the facades of those buildings from having been peppered with endless air conditioning units. For example, the hot air will be pumped into the car park through a concrete labyrinth, and then they will be pumped up as cool air, optimum air of about 20 degrees into the apartments. Solar panels used as street shading. The hydrology map, I guess, you know, where you show water reservoirs and anaerobic digesters, where natural nutrients, human nutrients, are then recycled, processed, and then fed back to the farming community, the farming land. These are the kind of obligatory bling blings that we have to produce. As I said, you know, not only does China want eco-cities, this is the one that we finished about 10 days ago, so it's a preview. I'm not sure what happened to it. In Nordhavn in Copenhagen, this is just by the docks of Copenhagen, they wanted almost an identical program to the Chinese one. So it was kind of interesting to work on the same program, similar requirements, but in very different cultures, very different climate. Because obviously Copenhagen, they have four seasons. Shenzhen is subtropical and humid all the time. So those are slight differences. Apart from that, they wanted almost exactly the same thing. I'm not going to talk about it tonight because we just finished it and we don't know what's happened to it yet. This one is quite small. This one is only about 2-point-something kilometers. On the same site, we were invited back to look into the a centerpiece of Guangming, which was the park itself. Again, you know, we were very concerned that, you know, if you can't save the whole site from sort of getting rid of all these wonderful eco-warriors, the farmers, we could at least retain a part of them. So the concept was very simple. It was about these sort of metaphorically ripples that ripples through this whole city. And each of the islands that you will see will be very similar to this here. And the park itself is an arable park. It's not a park with just a bit of roses, rose bushes and daisies in there, but it's a park that would serve and feed the community. So these hubs here are lychee orchards. The green, the light green, will all be farmland completely. And it would metaphorically spread into suburb centers on the same site. The river that we talked about earlier on, which is absolutely filthy, we actually, in this case, we blocked it. We blocked it, and what we've done is that we actually planted flowers through it. So it became this urban flower bed. What is kind of interesting about this site now is that the government is slicing it up piece by piece after the master plan and asking different practices to make proposals again. So it's like, and it was incredibly spooky for us to actually do the project twice over, but sort of similar but not the same. So in the middle of these lychee orchards are the flower beds, but also the sound gardens. This sort of gives you a kind of texture of a journey through the park. The little dog is Jeff Koons, is not mine. I wish it's mine. I love the dog. You didn't say, ah, isn't it sweet? And what we were really concerned about is that the park is not just an isolated island. It has these satellites. So what you get is that you get these visual connections throughout the whole city. And the thing is that, like everything, we have, you know, TV shows now, we have lots of reality shows. Here, we also want to incorporate a slice of reality where you and I, or anybody living in the city, could vote online and make these, have a virtual garden. So we can all have our virtual garden without getting our nails dirty. So the more people vote for them, the bigger the flower will grow. So on the back of, it's possible, you know, it's like, it's no difference from voting for your pop idol. So on the back of these solar panels, what you get is that you get the flowers growing virtually. At about the same time, this one is slightly smaller. This is about, this is in Korea. It's a park, a cultural park for the Korean government this time. And it was about 7 kilometers square, just 1 kilometer smaller than the other one. By the way, a lot of these projects I'll be showing here, we have been on the short list, or rather the final list, on many, many of them. And this one, we didn't win. We were on the final list, but we didn't win. The one that won had 3 rows of trees in them. So, and what you'll see is that my office panicked when we showed this scheme. I'll show you this scheme here. And they said, oh, CJ, there's not much there to do. And I said, okay, we'll try it. And then to their shock horror, the one that won only had 3 rows of trees. Did I sound bitter? No. I'm a good loser. Like the Chinese scheme, this is also a very, very beautiful piece of farming land. And this is the site here. The new administration city is just here. And around here, they're all housing. So the Seoul will be moved into this area in the future. And what was really important was that they have 4 boxes here. These are the museums which we're not allowed to touch in our scheme. This was the rooftop scheme that the administration city, this is somebody else's. And so we thought that we would continue this language of a sort of artificial sky garden. Ours was man-made lawn, manicured lawn, perfect lawn that floats over like these floating piers over the very rustic farmland. So we retain all the farmland, we kept all the farmers, we want the farmers to work on the garden. They will be new park keepers, the gardeners in the park. And what we added was just four lawn piers floating above it, peppered with orchards, pear and peach orchards, which was the local specialty there. This is a texture that we were hoping for, a texture of vegetables, pear and peach blossoms, the perfect manicured lawn surface, and lotus. And underneath the piers, there will be these sports centers and other sort of requirements that they wanted. And the components on a single pier. It was really interesting. We didn't choose tiles or bricks or whatever. We chose grass. So we spent the whole time choosing grass that is walkable on and grass that you cannot walk on. And the grass, which is of one type of color to another type of color. It was an enlightening experience. And we also chose, we were very careful about the contrast between one orchard blossom, the peach against the pear, against the grass, the different colors of the grass. Like all our schemes, we always must have a beach. So we had a beach. I don't know why we have a beach. We also have these sort of activities inserted into the pier itself, from sort of picnic holes to, courtyards to these sort of circular floating swimming pools, or sound gardens, secret gardens for artistic activities, identified by single color blossom. This is the kind of idea of the lawn pier, the garden. The vegetable underneath it. And this model, I told this joke last week. I'm going to tell it again. I think probably Ricardo will know exactly what I'm talking about. This was the final model for stage two of the competition. And, we only spent, 12 people for about 2 months on this project. But the things that, was really interesting was that we sent this model and the whole package 5 days beforehand. 5 days, actually, yeah, more than 5 days, about 5-6 days before the deadline, by FedEx. And the thing is that they sent it instead to Seoul. FedEx sent the entire package to Alaska. What I'm trying to tell you is that all of you, I'm sure, will be doing competitions, have clients that have deadlines to meet. So my mission in life now is to bitch about FedEx till the day I drop dead. So. Do not send packages which are important by FedEx. And it arrived 15 minutes before the deadline. It's really quite ridiculous. And this model is one of my favorite pieces. It was knitted by my German assistant. You can see in great detail. We wanted two textures, basically. The basic story about it is we wanted two textures. The artificial, which is this lawn, which we made from paper, and then the very textured, rustic, farmland made from wool. So Pascal knitted it for 2 weeks. You can tell he knitted it because he went crazy. Do that again? Wow. I will tell Pascal that you had sympathy for him. But the thing is that it's with the Korean government now. So the thing is that he did promise me, Pascal being very nice to me. He promised to make me another one. I think we love working on large-scale projects. I think it was really, really refreshing for us to change tactics, to change scale, because we were going absolutely no bloody where working on singular buildings. I don't know why. People were not interested. I mean, we got nowhere with anything. So when we changed scale, we seemed to got a lot of invitations to participate in limited competitions or to make proposals for different governments and things like that. And here, there was it's a proposal for the Tangshan government. And Tangshan had, in 1975, had a terrible earthquake. This was way before the Sichuan earthquake, which was a few months ago. And in Tangshan, this was the site. It was about 1 kilometer wide. And they wanted, basically, they more or less stated that they wanted the Vietnam War Memorial. And we said, no, we don't want Vietnam War Memorial with names and all that thing. So we said we wanted a much more abstract representation to honor the people who died, but also to honor your city. So what we have is that we have the River of Lost Souls, of flowers, the avenues of bravery to identify the bravery of the community that to rebuild their lives after the disaster in 1975. The ghosts of the past, basically having grass planted on the foundation of ruined buildings. And then these pits are the pavilions for the Earthquake Science Museum. It's very simple. The ghosts of the past is literally like these sort of relics in Scotland, where you have very shallow soil. And because of the different root depth of the grass, you would get different colors. So you get this sort of lighter shade of grass. I'm a grass expert now. And you can really, really get a very beautiful, ghostly peppering over the landscape. And the Avenue of Bravery are these poplar trees which stand absolutely upright and very straight. They're almost like army marching through the park. And the area, Tangshan, is well known for its ceramics and tiles. So the thing is that what we used later on was to use ceramics to tile the broken ceramics, the crushed ceramics, to tile these pits, which are the pavilions for the Earthquake Science Museum. We were invited again by the Sichuan government this time, a few months ago, to make a proposal for Sichuan for a landmark. And I thought the brief was a bit ill-conceived in a sense, because the earthquake just happened, people still don't have housing to live in, and so forth. Why on earth would you want a landmark to commemorate? So we said that our landmark are these sort of 1,000 flowers of Sichuan that floats from the main city of Sichuan and bring supplies across the sky to the ruined area. So you get this kind of floating landscape. In a way, it's very similar to Archigram's Instant City. This is a project I presented about 2 weeks ago. This is the first one that we didn't actually win. It was an invited competition. This is one I had an argument, huge arguments at the interview with the jury panel, who were complete idiots. And actually, I think one of them is a head of school in an architectural school. I'm not going to give you names, but he was a total asshole. And the thing is that, okay, that was a side story. I can tell you all the stories. It was most bizarre because the thing is that we were interviewed for the first time behind a screen because the Chinese government was determined that it has to be anonymous. I could have done it via the telephone. And I was placed behind a screen and then I have to stick my arm around this way to point at the fucking image. And then you get these sort of juries, you know, which these, there are three sort of Western juries among the Chinese juries who were completely disinterested in anything one has to say. So as you can see, I'll explain a little bit, and I can tell you all the bitching that went on. It's much more interesting. I can tell you the stories I can tell about them. The black patches are existing buildings on the site. This entire site is a university campus for science and technology in Shenzhen, and is a very, very political and important project, hence the screen, so that they said it's fair play, blah, 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 and all that thing. So the Chinese government is really going overdrive on being democratic and fair. So that's okay. But the thing is that, you know, then they said we have to keep all these buildings here, which are currently factories and so forth. So the idea here is to, and then they have farming here again. So the idea here, our proposal, is to decant these people from here above, that lives here, will be decanted into district, into a new small village town. And then the rest of them will be the university campus for science and technology. These black patches, existing buildings, we turn them into student accommodation. So they become the anchoring points for the entire campus. There are two basic ideas. One was the periodic table. The other was amoeba. And we simply laid the periodic table over the entire site to give us this division, this gridding. And the amoebas being the environmental trellis that would have solar panels, shading, flowers to identify the different faculties. There are five faculties here. And the faculties are divided in zones, just like the way you would read a periodic table. Or the columns of the periodic table would determine the height of the special buildings on each of the periodic patch block. And the first thing they complained about was that, do you realize your scheme is sprawl? I said, yes. He said, I'm a professor in a university of, you know, how could I communicate with my fellow professor in a different faculty? And I said, you know, how often does fellow professors communicate with fellow professors, especially in a different faculty? And I can tell you, I don't even communicate with professors across the corridor from me. Okay, that's me being unsociable. But the thing is that then another juror, she said, oh, I have to visit my PhD student to give tutorials. And I already wanted to say, what sort of relationship do you have with this PhD student that you have to visit him or her? So it didn't go down well. I mean, the trick is that all I'm saying to you is that CJ committed terrible sin and lost the competition. Please don't do that next time when you present a project to idiots of jurors. And these are the trellises that then encase the existing buildings, the greenery, the lifelines, the routes that go through it, the spots are bicycle stops. And each of the streets are numbered horizontally, and this way they are named after Nobel Prize scientists. The relationship between the lifelines and the podiums. The podiums, the special buildings, as you can see, these are the special towers. The river of sports facilities. I guess this is where nature meets technology, the solar panels, the flowers. The idea was that each faculty would have a different type of flower, so it would be, you know, the different smells and color would help identify each of the faculty rather than having to say, you know, this is science and biochemistry or physics or whatever. The model. I would behave very badly at this competition. At the end of the interview, I told the guys, pack up the model, and we fucked off. We left and took the model home. I think, you know, for somebody who has been around for a long time like myself, and you kind of like, and you have worked on 119 schemes and not got anywhere, and I do mean anywhere, you kind of lose heart. And in the last 2 years, we have been shortlisted for we have been finalists and shortlisted for about 11 projects. And you know, and every time you come so close and you think, this is my chance now, and never materialize. And you know, it becomes very disheartening and a bit scary in a way. Even if you don't get anywhere, it's not so bad. You say, oh, you know, we'll get there next time. But then when you're so close to winning a competition, and it's really, really, really disheartening. And thank God on the 12th one, we won it. This is something we won a few months back, again for the Chinese government. It's a project for mixed use, hotels, offices, apartments, and a shopping mall with a public park in the middle of it. It was based on the golden bowl in a Chinese culture. We thought, we'll do anything to win. We are. Brad could tell you that I'm cheap, you know. So instead of actually having money in this courtyard, we have green. We want to provide healthy living. So the golden bowl in the 21st century is no longer about wealth. It's about green living. We also want transparency throughout the entire building. We provided a public central park on ground floor or lower ground floor. And because this is a very expensive development, we actually have a private garden, which is a ribbon that floats above the 8 blocks underneath it. The 8 blocks basically, you know, in Shenzhen, 150 meters, which is the highest bit of this development, it's actually very, very low. So we actually said, rather than accentuating the height of each of the 8 blocks, we actually accentuate this urban courtyard, this enormous, enormous courtyard, to accentuate the horizontality of it. And yes, it is gold. We have gone very, very bling as well. The Chinese love it. So you have to give them what they want. And the blue are the solar panels. Shenzhen has, you know, a lot of sunlight. So why don't we clad the buildings with these solar panels? On the south and the west side, you get these blue facades. And the main entrance into the complex has to be this 200 meters wide grand entrance. This is a facade study. And also the other thing is that it's also quite good that sometimes when you have presentation, the image doesn't show up on PowerPoint. And you tell them the story, and they would think it's something fantastic. This drawing did not show up when my assistant explaining the scheme in Mandarin, it was blank on the wall because these guys in the office, they don't listen to me. They drew everything in light, the thinnest gray lines that doesn't show. So during the presentation, we were explaining the facades, and there was a blank wall. And probably that's the thing that won us the scheme. The individual models, we were very cynical about this. So the way we worked it was that we also chopped up the schemes into towers. We say, okay, I know we shouldn't have towers, but the thing is, if you want towers, it can give you towers. It sounds desperate. We were desperate. And the relationship between the upper ribbon and the lower park. And in Chinese presentation, you have to give them these blink night views as well. They love it. You guys must love what I'm saying. You're enjoying it, aren't you? Okay, I'm going to skip through this very, very quickly now because this is 10 past 7. I'm going to show you my favorite project so far. It was a project that we did for Venice Biennales, a couple of Venice Biennales ago. It was all to do with West and East culture. And these two chaps here, one is called, this is Marco Polo, Kublai Khan. Tales have been written, history books have been written about them, their relationship. But to me, they represent East and West. They represent my existence. Me from Malaysia, and then been in London for over 20 years. And my understanding of space and architecture and so forth is all, you know, I really think in English now. If you ask me to explain a scheme in Chinese, Cantonese, or Mandarin, I would not be able to do that. And I could order, you know, roast duck rice very fluently in Mandarin, but that's the limit of it. But so I just wanted to skip through it very quickly. But the thing is that it's a scheme very dear to us. Also, in terms of technique, it was also very important. When we were invited to the Venice Biennale, of course, you know, we said, oh, we are very excited, you know, and so forth. It was the year where, you know, the British Council invited us. It was curated by Peter Cook that year. And we said, yeah, we'd love to do it. We have lots of ideas. We actually, in actual fact, we didn't have any idea whatsoever. So during the summer months, we really worked it up. And it was actually really quite exciting. The project consists of seven parts to it. And we actually took very, very known places in Venice and recreated it through the Eastern eye. History has always written about Venice, the relationship between Kublai Khan and Marco Polo, through the Western eyes all the time. So this one, we turn it round. It was a homage about Venice, the city, but it's through Kublai Khan's eyes. It's actually through my eyes. And it was really special because the team that worked on it, I specially selected them. And the first question was not about can you make models or can you draw or can you design, is that have you been to Venice? And the team never been to Venice. So they only saw it virtually on Google pictures and so forth. So it was very, very important that all the people that worked on it never been to Venice, just like Kublai Khan. So he imagined Venice in the Calvino book. He only imagined Venice through the conversation he had with Marco Polo. And for those who are first year here, I guess, I would really recommend, highly recommend that you read Invisible Cities by Calvino. It's absolutely, absolutely fantastic book. The first one, St. Marco, a square of pigeons, a square that we use as a vehicle to describe culinary delights between the East and the West. So if St. Marco is this square here, horizontal, we flipped it around 90 degrees, and made it into the Tower of Death, a tower where pigeons are captured in the facade, hung, and then eaten in these chandelier dining rooms. And the model was a very abstracted model. So the pieces that showed red was basically identify the pigeon has been caught. It identifies with death. The ovens that cooks the pigeons floating in the lagoon. The ovens. St. Michael, the cemetery. Here, we didn't want to make it into a cemetery. We wanted a place to rest. If you have been to Venice before, you would know that the city is only, you could only really experience it by walking around these narrow streets and along the canals itself. And here we wanted a place to rest. And we built a series of pavilions to represent St. Michael, where it's the reference are these Japanese samurai warrior suits. So remember, all the references has to be Eastern. And so these are the beginnings of the pavilions. And each piece of cladding on this model is actually a reduced photocopy of Chinese and Japanese newspaper. St. Michael as a cluster of pavilions to rest, a sound garden, the promenade where you sit on. And what was really interesting is that when I went there, you read in all the guidebooks, and you're going to, you know, they tell you that they have about 30,000 cats in Venice, but when I went there, I only saw dogs. So that was part of the story here too, where the pigeons will flock on this deck and the cat will just appear. You can see that here? And the cat, when it jumps up to catch the pigeon, it turns into St. Mark the Lion. The Sound Garden. The section through the pavilion. You can see little feet here dipping itself into the salt baths. This is the eight gods crossing the sea. In Venice, every so often you get these sort of monster of cruise liners coming through. And when I was there doing my research for the project, trying to be inspired and get inspired, I was in this hotel, the bedroom window was open. It was next to the water. And suddenly, to my big surprise, I have these sort of people waving from the ship, which is literally next to the window to me. And I was extremely shocked. I was actually fully dressed, but it was fine. This is what happened. The windows play a very important part to the sort of to life in Venice. These windows, when they open, the laundry comes out. So what we created was this big urban laundry machine that glides very quietly in through the lagoon into the canals of Venice. And its tentacles, these tentacles here, there are eight of them, they are gardens. And the wiry things is the washing line. So the things that you can actually have the garden next to your window for the duration where your laundry is dried. So when the laundry dries, you have to return the garden. This was also the beginning, the first time when we actually tried this technique of representing ideas through this layering collage technique. I don't know what you call them. But I think you can actually see some of them in your gallery here, some of the projects, which was done later. And this was a model that we made. Again, you know, it really was just showing the main sort of body and then these floating gardens. The Lido. Lido is a beach in Venice. And to me, this is very much what evokes my inspiration for the piece. We wanted a beach, not of sand, but of woven lemongrass. So when you walk along this and rub your feet against lemongrass, it would perfume the air with this distinctly eastern smell. So you can imagine an entire landscape of woven lemongrass. And yesterday's newspaper, pavilions made from yesterday's newspaper on structures of this kind. In Venice, you can get Italian newspaper on the day, but generally any other language is about 2 weeks old, and Chinese newspaper is probably about a month old. So we thought, what do you do with all this newspaper? It would be really great to have this little pavilion stuck in the lagoon, you know, made the shading of it would be made from yesterday's newspaper. The thing is that this thing is blinking. Okay. Friends of mine, you know, my Western friends, they always think that Chinese people can fly. Is it true? How many of you who are from Asia could fly here? Who could fly like Zhang Yiyi in Crouching Tiger or, you know, whatever this film is? I cannot fly, I can tell you this. So the things that, you know, I thought it's also important that we poke fun of ourselves, you know, and the culture. And so what we did was that we made these bamboo structures, these what we call the telephone booths. So the thing is that if to make a telephone back home, you have to wind yourself up to the top of it to make a telephone call. And because Venice is so flat, from the top of this structure, you could actually report back chapter by chapter, view by view, of this incredible majestic view, landscape of Venice. The Giardini. The Giardini are 29 different international pavilions waiting to be filled every year by art and architectural work. Otherwise, it's empty. They're like empty vessels. What we have here, instead of just trees, we have a lemon grove that surrounds these vessels. What we also wanted was that it wasn't so much the grove, the lemon grove, that made up the pavilions or the vessels itself. We wanted languages from different countries. In every country, there's the 6 o'clock news, the important news. So the things that the Giardini, the park, will constantly broadcast different texture, different language textures to make the space. So the space is no longer made by the physical, it's made by different textural languages. This is a view from If You Are a Fish. The office forced me to put it in. The lemon. So the lemon juice is provided, each visitor is provided with a little tub of lemon juice and a brush. And the fence is made of paper, so you can actually graffiti it. Like anything else, we always like to graffiti something. So on New Year's Eve, the fence will be set alight. And lemon juice, when it comes in contact with heat, you can actually see the secret messages for one split second. And of course, you know, C.J.Lim would never have an ordinary cloud sky. Our sky have to be made of these enormous paper carp floating over the skies of Venice, broadcasting four seasons, Vivaldi's four seasons, because Vivaldi was born there. So this piece was a homage to Vivaldi himself. I think that's it. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Can I open the floor to questions?
Let's give them a minute to settle.
This is our opportunity. We got CJ back after only 20 years to come into the room.
Yeah. Just a second. Let me get the microphone over.
Thank you.
First one's regarding your projects in China with the beaches. I thought an eco-city would probably use local materials. And what about the transport costs for bringing in sand for the beaches? And also the energy used in transporting agricultural land in the vertical agricultural spaces.
I think it's a very valid question about materials. Obviously, you need to bring material from somewhere. And I think having an eco city, having a sustainable city, is not about saying everything has to be local, everything has to be cheap, everything has to be. I think it's like doing your bank account. You know, you can't say that I'm not going to eat because I want to save money, but you have to eat and you have to save money at the same time. So you have to do a balance sheet. What is important? You have to get your priorities right. So you might lose some eco points on some things, you will gain on other bigger things. And what we're interested in is the bigger picture, the long-term strategy. You know, not the short-term cost, but the long-term strategy. I guess it's something that, you know, which is very, very important.
Hello. In the proposed design that you do for China, which is design a new city, one of the main concepts is to retain the farm and the field. I think it's a great idea, but there's something slightly not right, because when the farmer stay in a city, they get to know, you know, clubbing, bar, how long they stay to be farmer, and that feel, beautiful feel in the walkways, and it's like fragments, like decorative fragment. I get to see feel, you know, in front of the mountain, behind the mountain, and now it's surrounding by concrete block. It's just kind of weird. And then you see this new citizen of the city walking a beautiful skywalk, driving the car slowly, and say, like, look at the farmer, they're walking in a field, how beautiful it is, romantics, and then it's just like a typical scenery in the zoo, and the farmer is like animal in the cage. They are not where they belong. And plus, you're walking in the field right here, and people are going to the beach next door. It's just not right. Kind of weird.
I mean, to bring it into a question, should the farmers be there? Would be the question.
Because
I think it's a really interesting question, because the thing is that, obviously, I would say yes, the farmer should be there. The farmer should be there, but also, I think it's not as simple as what I presented. I think the government has to do a bit of homework first to elevate the status of the farmers, to really value their contribution in terms of food production. Because the things that now, I don't know if you heard, that even in China, there's shortage of rice production in South Asia. And the thing is that there must be some sort of program to really, by the United Nations or the individual countries in the Far East, to really look into the input, the contribution farmers would make. And then probably then, you know, one could discuss their status. But the thing is that what I find kind of interesting in your question is that you are incredibly conservative in what is sort of acceptable. You know, I am not wealthy. I go to Knightsbridge sometimes. Do you think I'm a zebra in a cage in Knightsbridge? You know, I am not white, and I stay in a very white neighborhood. Does it make me an animal in a zoo, as you put it? I think, you know, what is important here is about mixing, to have cities which have different social strata, different salary back brackets. Otherwise, what you have is that there are cities in China now where they are predominantly built for middle class and upper class citizens. Beautiful places designed by very, very interesting architects. And they are very, very scary. And then you also have ghettos where you only have factory workers, construction workers staying, not just in China, even in Dubai, in the Middle East. You know, they are terrible ghettos. And I think, you know, we have to be very careful when we make these master proposals that there must be mixed use, mixed community. And what we proposed was that there will be 25% low-income government-supported housing within the proposal itself, which is a bit higher than what they would sort of accept anyway. But I think that was very important because we actually visited places where you only have one kind, and one kind is not good. And I think, you know, you should know better if you're studying at the AA here. This is an incredibly global international school. This is successful because you are a very international school. I think, another question?
Yes, thank you.
I would like to know that by perception of smart cities, are we approaching the concept and idea of utopia? Because, well, the images that shown that these cities are very kind of like, it's hard to think that it's possible to be done. So it seems that it's kind of like part of utopia city in future. So, and if so, I had another question related to that, that are there any kind of clear clarification for smart cities? Are there any kind of way to define the features of the smart cities?
I think us architects could do as much as we can at the moment by making these proposals. It's a long way to make it like the drawings, like the ideal condition. It costs a lot of money. It requires a lot of conviction by the government. But I think if these smart cities, this eco-city, incorporates a lot more human programs into it, rather than it looking like science projects, like some other ones, I'm not going to name which ones, then it is possible. It is possible, and people want to live there, and it is sustainable. And like all projects, when you know, even if on a smaller scale, you can actually design an incredible form. But then if you didn't consider it with a human narrative inside it, a human program, it would be a vacant space. It would be of no use to anybody. So either large scale or small scale, I think a human program is very, very important. And of course, the conviction of the client, the people that use the building or the use the city and so forth is very important. I think the big issue here is money at the end of the day. You know, to do a big city like that requires a lot of money, and hopefully the Chinese government could afford it because they have a lot of money and they have poured in a lot of money into grand projects that we in the West would never see, not in my lifetime anyway. So, you know, and I think we can hope. And I think architects, we are here to imagine, we can here to propose, we are here to hope. I don't think I'm here in my lifetime here to solve the world's problems. I don't think I will be solving any economical problems at all and any sort of green living. We can only hope that maybe if this doesn't get implemented as it is, there's next generation of architects and designers and urban planners and environmentalists who are interested in this similar subject that could push it a little bit further. And we can only push it a little bit further. I think that's the whole point. I think, you know, my whole point of teaching for so long is that it's not because I can change the world or I have great things to say. I'm not Le Corbusier, neither am I Zaha Hadid, you know. But the thing is that I think if I could actually move the conversation a little bit, and if all of you could move the conversation about having a green city, about having healthy living, about being low carbon, don't fly so much, you know, don't drive so much, we might help. If all of us contribute to a little bit, we will actually help. Yeah, it has a much more socially caring program rather than just being a science project of how renewable energies could be attained. One more question?
Here's one.
Okay.
Well, it really caught my attention, like the very first part of the Biennale of Venezia, because somehow that intrigues me is how is the exercise over thinking in such a scientific kind of project so well studied as designing a city, and the other one that is so related to fantasy and to traditional features about the, Marco Polo, and it's like really creative. And on the other hand, you have such a scientific and investigational work from designing a city.
I think that's actually a very interesting question, because I get asked a lot, because if you can see the range of projects we do, we flick from one mode to another. The fantastical projects are absolutely crucial to my thinking process. I think, you know, if I didn't work on projects similar to the mode of the Virtually Venice project, the Marco Polo project, then I probably would not be able to conjure up these more poetic narratives for this sort of what you call scientific city. I think this is just a way that I work. It's not a formulae for everybody. But I think for me to work in very poetic narratives and then trying to impose these poetic narratives into urban master plans has helped us incredibly. Maybe it makes some of our projects, our master plan projects, a bit weird. A lot of urban planners said that it doesn't look or sound like any master plans that they know, but that's beside the point. I think what we were most concerned about, like our narrative projects, we were concerned with the smaller issues, the more tactile, more poetic, more human issues. And here, applying narratives into master plans made our projects slightly more humane than your general master plans. And I think I would recommend this to people that, you know, you should switch channels sometimes, because it gives you, it clears your brain sometimes, I think. But I love my narratives. I mean, as you can see, I mean, I didn't have a chance to talk about sins, which was all based on the seven deadly sins, or How Green Is Garden, which was entirely devoted to Alice and Alice in Wonderland, and so forth. But we work very, very, we take sort of epics.